Thank you, guys. So we're here today to talk with two people who are really working on the front lines of some of these exciting breakthroughs that we have in pediatric cancer. And I just wanted to kind of start with kind of setting the scene as to why we need immunotherapy for pediatric cancer. So maybe you guys could briefly tell us a little bit about kind of what we see with chemotherapy in pediatric patients. Why is it important to maybe look for alternatives to chemotherapy?
I probably get started because I work with a program called St. Jude Life, which is headed by Dr. Les Robinson from St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. He established this program to look into the long-term side effect of treatment in pediatric cancer patients. So what we observed that these kids are at higher risk in developing secondary cancer as adults. They have frailty, problems, movement, heart diseases, cardiovascular diseases, obesity, diabetes, and also long-term damage to brain due caused by radiation therapy. So this all indicating that, you know, treating patients in pediatric cancer is different from adult cancer in that it's not only saving the lives of the children, but also to ensure there is a quality of life after their survival.
And I'd just like to add to what Dr. Jinghui just said, that there is long-term consequences of the chemotherapies that we give, but there are also certain diseases that we haven't made progress as much as we would like to make. For children with brain tumors, children with solid tumors that are advanced when they're diagnosed, I think we really need to do more research to find better strategies and newer strategies to allow us to treat them better.
And why are our children not just small adults? Why is it more complicated or different to create immunotherapies for pediatric cancer?
So the one of the studies I recently completed is look at the genomic landscape of pediatric cancer. And this study was published in the Journal of Nature, and we also compared the similar studies carried out in adult cancer. So what we found out, there is only about 50% of the overlap of driver genes found in pediatric cancer patients compared with adult cancer. So this is why if you try to fit the treatment protocols that developed in adult cancer to pediatric cancer patients, these are not well fit. And it is part due to the issue that the pediatric cancer arise from the development tissues, while the adult cancer patients arise from different organs. So you won't expect there is gonna be 1 to 1% match in these two categories. And this is why more research is needed to develop pediatric cancer-specific therapy.
And so I guess, so I've heard about immunotherapy a couple times, and actually talking to you guys is the time that I've really understood it the best. So can you walk us through kind of exactly how it works? Like why, how can you get your immune system to attack cancer like you would, you know, a cut or scrape?
Yeah, so as we were talking, I think why we believe immunotherapy might be a very good strategy to treat cancer, and it's already showing a lot of promise, is because what we've learned from all these genome studies is cancer is complex, and that cancer evolves. And so you need a system that is as smart as the cancer and can actually evolve and recognize all the changes in the cancer. And we believe that immune system is one such strategy that one can employ. Another really important factor that we think will help with immune therapies is that we develop memory. So if you have had a viral infection, for example, the first time around, it might take you a little while to overcome that. But the second time around, you may not even get that infection because your immune system kind of remembers that virus and remembers to kind of attack the virus when it enters your body. And we think that we can do the same with the immune system, that you can have memory for a tumor cell. And so what we are seeing, say, in adults with melanoma who are getting some of the immune therapies is they're getting really durable responses after they finish the chemotherapy, after they finish the immune therapy. And that's why we think, because they have developed a memory response. But having said that, you know, immune therapy has been around for a long time, but it was not successful because we really didn't know a lot about what the immune cells were, how do they recognize the tumor. But over the last 10 years, we've learned a lot. So we know who the players are, we know how to modulate them. And so I think going forward, we have better strategies that we could use to engage the immune system to treat cancer.
And so what are the, I guess, what are the financing options available for this? Because from what I've heard, I mean, it's quite expensive. It can cost somewhat like $500,000 for some of these. So how do families typically pay for these, or how do hospitals typically pay for these?
Yeah, so I came from St. Jude. So the generous support of donors, charity organizations, has become the major resource for supporting both research and treatment of pediatric cancer patients. So in our hospital, we have actually performed the whole genome sequencing of every pediatric cancer patient enrolled in our hospital. And the result information were discussed among the tumor board members, that including scientists from both the oncologist, you know, pathologist, and immunotherapist, and also computational biologist like me. So we go through the data together and then disseminate the information and come up with what is the right regimen for treating this patient based on the specific mutation profile that we have derived from the sequencing initiative.
And you sequence the genome of every patient, right?
Every patient in St. Jude, yes.
Wow. So what does that allow you to do? Why is that a beneficial?
So that allow you to stratify patients, because mm-hmm. some patients probably will be working well, have predicted good outcome from conventional therapy. Others may not have. And others may better suited for immunotherapy, because there is what we call the term that we use technically is called hypermutator phenotype, meaning there is excessive amount of the DNA damage in the tumor cells in these patients.
And that's actually better for immunotherapy, right?
Immunotherapy, yeah.
Because then the immune system.
Because that allows because that allows a lot of abnormal protein to be exposed to the surface of the tumor. So the tumors have a lot of abnormal protein, and immune system recognizes what's not normal.
I see.
So that is why, and that is one of the bigger challenges in pediatric tumors for just regular immune therapy, is that adult tumors have a lot of abnormal protein because they've been exposed to a lot of environmental factors over many, many years, whereas pediatric tumors have very small numbers of abnormal protein. So the challenge is, how do we get the immune system to recognize these proteins? And the other big issue is that we don't actually know what the immune environment of the pediatric tumors is. You know, what are the cells that are in the pediatric tumors that we can actually harness or we can engage to treat these tumors? So I think there is, and we are starting to do that. We've had a lot of experience looking at microenvironment or immune environment, or what are the immune cells in the adult tumors, and we are using a lot of those strategies to now ask the same questions in pediatrics, because there might be different targets that we should be using for pediatric tumors.
Yeah. So the genome sequencing, Jinghui, allows you to share data, essentially. So talk a little bit about that data sharing.
Yeah, so this is a high commitment from our institution, in that we feel like we receive money from American people. All the donations coming from our donors are from American people. So we have our obligation to share our research findings and the data generated from our patients, provided the patient's family and consented to data sharing when they enroll in the protocol with the rest of the world, not just the United States. The reason what we committed to do this is because pediatric cancer is a rare disease. And one of the things that kind of preventing therapy moving forward is it's difficult to enroll sufficient patients in a specific treatment protocol. So at times, if we can combine the experiences from treatment carried out in United States as well as in other countries, maybe we can come up with protocols that's less toxic and have a better way of stratify patients. So this is why recently we launched the a platform called St. Jude Cloud, meaning by uploading all the genomic data generated in St. Jude to the cloud platform that enables broad research community, not just pediatric cancer researchers, but also computational scientists who can utilize big data computing to find patterns that can associate the outcome with genetic data to utilize this information to contribute from their expertise to the QRP pediatric cancer patients. So this is an effort we put a lot of resources, and it is in collaboration with Microsoft and DNA Nexus, these two commercial entities. They also, Microsoft provided the storage and space for this platform, because it's cost a lot of money. So we cannot do that alone.
So that way your small amount of patients can actually get bigger through data, kind of?
Yeah, the impact of the research we do can be disseminated across globe.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm going to take questions from the audience in a minute. But first, I wanted to ask you guys, if you had a policy change or something that could happen at the federal level with healthcare that could make your jobs easier, is there anything on your policy wish list?
I'd say more funding for research.
More funding? Okay.
Yeah, absolutely, because I think we can't assume that what we know for adult tumors is correct for pediatric tumors, and so we need more funding. We need more funding for clinical trials, for research, so that we can enroll. And the good thing about pediatric oncology is that all of us collaborate. All the pediatric oncologies, the centers, all collaborate because we understand that our primary goal is to move the field forward. And luckily it is rare, that we do need to engage all the centers in the U.S. So I think, you know, having collaborative grants, more research funding, more clinical support trial, I think is gonna help.
I agree 100%. And also talking about the collaboration aspect, team science is absolutely needed, because every one of us can only be good at one specific aspect. And if the research funding is only working on your own independent component, but does not have sufficient funding for encouraging team science, it is difficult to translate what we learned from basic biology to treatment.
All right. Do we have questions in the audience? Questions? One up here. There's mic runners that you guys have to wait for.
Oh, you'll hold the mic. Thanks. Yeah, I just really wanted the mic. No. Hi, I'm Kim. I'm with Fenton, and I wanted to learn a little more about the genomic sequencing and also the aggregation of big data and how you share it over the cloud. Are there ethical or privacy implications there that you guys have run across or come into, and how does St. Jude's navigate that?
Yeah. Thank you for the question. Yes, so this is where the data sharing obviously has to go through the consenting process. And what we have done is, you know, before kids are 18 years old, the parents consent. Once they reach 18 years old, we actually will reconsent the patients to be sure that they become adult, they are comfortable of sharing the genomic data. The sharing itself is in a secure environment. It is not everyone can go to the internet and Google and download any person's data. So this is why we work with a company called DNA Nexus. They also worked with the FDA, has implemented a lot of the data security measures on the cloud. And all the any researchers who wants to access data, they have to fill out the form to make sure they only use data for research purposes. And this data use is only for 1 year that they have to renew every year. So there also need to be some institutional backup about the claim that they are going to use this data for this specific research purposes. Mm. So you know, but we want to make sure this consenting, you know, the data sharing agreement to be streamlined enough that it does not take a researcher 9 months to get permission to use the data. So this is where that we also working with the global community in a sense to make sure that the researchers who wants to use the data can access to, but also ensure there's a secure data security once we post the data on the cloud.
Other questions? up here, this woman has her hand up right here.
So I think that's a great question, and I think we don't really know the answer to what you're asking. I suspect some of the things that you might be thinking about is that the tumor is quite different at relapse versus initial therapy, and that's true. But I think as the immune therapies get better and more effective in the relapse setting, we will try to take them, at diagnosis, because really what we are trying to do are get therapies that are more targeted towards the tumor and less towards the normal tissue. But I think that's a process that I think some of the diseases are going towards that, and we can see that already happening in the adult setting. So I am thinking that that's exactly where we will go with pediatrics once we have really good data about how they're working in the relapse setting, that we want to incorporate them early on so that we can avoid the toxicities and allow for a much better quality of life for the patients.
And you guys mentioned this is still pretty early, right? So hopefully
yes.
We learn more and more about this. Unfortunately, I think that's our time, but this is fascinating stuff. Thank you so much, Kavita and Jinghui, and thank you guys for coming.
Thank you.